ऑप्टिकल मेजरमेंट, देयर आर मेनी मेथड्स ऑफ ऑप्टिकल मेजरमेंट एंड इट कुड बी सिंपल इंटेंसिटी मॉड्यूलेशन और अदर काइंड ऑफ मॉड्यूलेशन टेक्निक्स कैन बी यूज्ड. सो इफ वी डिस्कस अबाउट ऑप्टिकल सेंसर, so in a typical optical sensors, there would be first optical source, and then a transmission medium. That is optical fiber, then we have optical modulator. And in some cases we have a readout scheme. And then we have a optical detector. So this is in brief the methodology of optical measurement. Though the measurement technique is implemented in a roundabout manner, because the signal of the measurement is embedded in terms of certain optical quantity. So here we have measurement, which is basically used to modulate. So this is a physical quantity. Like say temperature, pressure, voltage, current, etc. So these are the measurement which is used to modulate. Now what is modulated? The modulated quantities can be phase, polarization, and intensity, frequency. So basically, due to this perturbation by a measurement in an optical modulator, which is basically a sensitive, optically sensitive medium, due to this perturbation, one of these quantity may change. So all these are related to certain kind of optical state, like phase is the phase difference. In terms of phase difference, we can say with respect to some reference, if we introduce some phase difference, then that can be treated as phase modulator. A popular example of phase modulator is an interferometer, where there is a reference arm and then another arm is a modulating arm. So the refractive index of the modulating arm changes, so thereby the optical path length changes, and therefore there is a phase difference introduced between the two arms. Similarly, there could be polarization change. So there are certain polarization state of the input optical beam. So due to application of all those like temperature, pressure, voltage, current, the polarization angle shifts. Then that so the measurement is embedded as a change in polarization angle. It can also be in terms of frequency. So frequency modulation, Bragg grating, etc. If the grating changes due to some stress, strain, electric field, magnetic field, etc. So then what will happen? The shift frequency will change. So that way there could be some frequency shift or frequency change which can be used to carry the information of the measurement. The simplest one is of course the intensity. So if directly the intensity changes due to change in absorption or due to change in certain alignment or angular deviation, so then there would be change in the intensity available at the coupling end. So there could be a coupler between this optical modulator and this readout scheme or the optical detector, so which can be viewed as a lens. So lens has an aperture, so due to some movement the radiation captured by in that aperture will change, so therefore we will have direct intensity modulation. Now optical detector are basically energy detector, so here always it has to be intensity. So this is nothing but intensity I. And optical detectors can only detect intensity. It cannot detect phase, it cannot detect change in polarization, it cannot detect change in frequency. So therefore, to convert this change in phase, polarization and frequency to a corresponding change in intensity, we have a readout scheme. What is a readout scheme? Readout scheme is for phase, it is an interferometer. For polarization, it is a polarizer, which converts the change in polarization angle to a corresponding change in intensity. For frequency, there would be a diffraction grating, which will basically change, the frequency change will be converted to a corresponding change in intensity, or there could be, say, optical filters. If a shifted frequency passed through a filter, then also there would be change in intensity. However, usually this frequency change is relatively very small, and the optical filters are not that much high resolution in terms of frequency. Though they have very narrow band, but still narrower band is required to measure a change in frequency in, say, megahertz or in terms of some megahertz, whereas optical frequency is of the order of petahertz, 10 to the power 15 hertz or so. So therefore, the components, those are used. Typical optical components. Used are source. Detector, optical ऑप्टिकल फाइबर, कापलर, सो देयर आर ऑप्टिकल का फॉर कापलिंग वेरियस काइंड ऑफ अरेंजमेंट्स आर नेसेसरी. देन then we have that optical sensing material. So we will discuss one by one. So for various kind of application, these components need to be chosen with various properties. Like for the source, there could be say broadband and narrowband. The detector is also can be broadband and narrowband. Optical fibers are single mode and multi mode. Couplers also can be single mode and multi mode, and sensing materials can be crystal, then polymers, optical fiber, and there could be other kind of things like some kind of deflecting arrangement made of various fabrication, mechanical fabrication is also possible. So optical sources, first we shall start with optical sources. So optical sources, as I was telling, that there are two kinds, broadband and narrowband. Broadband sources are basically thermal sources, whereas narrowband sources are semiconductor sources. Broadband thermal sources. Then narrowband semiconductor sources. For many applications, these broadband thermal sources are required because of their intensity, energy availability at a large range of wavelength. Say, generally thermal sources are some kind of thermal bulb, but that has to be very reliable. So for example, this is like quartz tungsten halogen lamp. So which has spectral radiation starting from UV to infrared, like say around 200 nanometer to 2000 nanometer or so. So first we shall discuss a little bit of properties of sources. The sources are characterized by the brightness and the intensity. Optical sources are characterized by brightness or intensity. By overall brightness and the intensity distribution and the intent and the bandwidth of radiation. That is the variation of intensity in terms of lambda. Typically, assuming that the source is like a point source, so the energy will be radiated in a solid angle. And if that is integrated over all the wavelengths, then we can get the brightness. Zero to infinity is lambda d lambda watt per centimeter square per unit area per unit solid angle steradian. So this is a per unit area. Per unit solid angle. On the other hand, the intensity is per lambda. Intensity is often expressed in terms of lambda.
Sir, what is S?
S is the energy radiated, that is the spectral density, power spectral density function of the energy radiation. In terms of wavelength.
Sir, can you please scroll up a bit? I missed it. Missed one place. Yes, sir. Thank you. Just a minute.
The lambda is the wavelength, so it is integrated over all the lambda.
Yes, sir. You can scroll down now. Thank you, sir.
So typically, taking a point source, it is like this. This is like delta A. Surface area. Small section in surface area. Is the angle theta. So if we have a delta omega here, the solid angle. Small solid angle. So then delta omega is equal to the surface area delta A by S equal to R theta. So from that to this is R. By R square. So power incident would be I theta, because intensity can have a profile with respect to the angle theta. So I theta into cos theta. Delta A by R square. This is per watt per micrometer inverse. So it is defined at a particular wavelength. Now this thing, if we integrate over all wavelength, we will get that total intensity. Now hot body sources, that the thermal sources, thermal sources have broadband radiation. Governed by the temperature of the hot body, emitting hot body. And the permissivity of the material. In case it is black body, it will the radiation will be maximum in uniform overall lambda. However, all practical sources are gray body, so it has an emissivity at a particular lambda, so therefore they have a radiation pattern. The spectral density, power spectral density for black body radiator is given by Planck's law.
Is incident power a function of lambda?
Which one?
So the incident power?
Yes. Because S we have defined as a function of lambda. So that's why it is a function of lambda.
So I mean that I theta cos theta, so sir, everything is here in terms of theta, so.
Yeah, but that I theta is equal to S lambda and some S cos theta.
Okay. Yes,
so
sir.
Basically, AS cos theta is the normal with respect to this theta angle. So this is the emitting angle. It has a certain profile. Had it been a point surface, so all these normals for a blackboard will be same. But for all practical sources, there will be this function will come. And I theta is a function coming from that S lambda, AS cos theta.
So S is when theta is at 90 degrees?
Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So the Planck's law for black body radiation, you know that W is a function of lambda and the temperature. That is given by Planck's constant C1 by lambda to the power 5. Then exponential of C2 by lambda into capital T temperature minus 1. So C1 is a constant. C1 is 37,413 watt. Micrometer to the power 4 per unit area, centimeter to the power minus 2. C2 is 14,388 micrometer into degree Kelvin. So this is coming from the dimensionality of this expression, those constants units. But this is valid for black body. Now, usually usually there are two other quantities. Those are important. That is the total energy or total power. Total power emitted by a black body W total equal to 0 to infinity, and this W lambda T d lambda, so that is equal to sigma t to the power 4 w per unit area, watt per centimeter square. So sigma is Stefan Boltzmann constant, 5.67 into 10 to the power minus 12 watt per centimeter square, k to the power minus 4. Then another important is the Wien's displacement law. So that is the position of the peak wavelength. Position in wavelength of the peak radiation. Wavelength corresponding to peak radiation is given by Wien's displacement law. Lambda P 2891 by capital T micrometer. So as the temperature increases, actually the wavelength shifts towards high frequency or shorter wavelength. This is lambda in micrometer, and this is W lambda T for black body. So so at a low temperature, there won't be any visible radiations, like here in the book it is given. This may correspond to, you can get the better figure from the book of Bentley that I shall circulate later. As the temperature increases, the peak wavelength will shift. Also, the total radiation will increase. Total radiation is the area under this curve. Thank you. So like that, more or less, I have not drawn very properly. So something like that, this could be around 500, because my drawing is little different. I think 600, it will sit little bit further, what is given in the book. This could be 700 in the book, that corresponding to 1000, what is given. So this one would be corresponding to maybe 900 or 1000 degree Kelvin, and this could be like 1500 then this would be like 90. So as you see that as the temperature increases, this the high frequency side is very sharp, and it falls in exponent, the curve gradually decay in exponential manner towards the infrared. Now, so therefore, as a temperature source corresponding to a particular lambda, it is very inefficient. So because it has a very wide band and low frequency divergent, which cannot be used as a meaningful signal. So then how to detect such kind of signal? To detect such kind of signal, you have to basically measure the temperature. So invariably, the radiation detector, that wide band radiation detectors, are temperature detectors. Means it is made usually by lot of thermocouples putting in series, or maybe lot of thermistors put in series. So those are having a very wide band sensitivity. So that we shall discuss little bit later. But then if the radiation is distributed over so much of distributed to such a wide zone of lambda, what is its utility? Its main utility is characterizations of the optical devices in terms of lambda. So that means optical device characterization, or to find out, say, absorption profile of optical devices in terms of lambda, you have to use wideband sources. Otherwise, for general instrumentation purpose, semiconductor sources are much more beneficial, because they are very efficient, much more efficient compared to these thermal sources. Because they are semiconductor sources, radiation will be limited to a narrow zone of wavelength corresponding to the band gap of that particular material. So that's why invariably for industrial instrumentation applications, semiconductor sources like LEDs and lasers are used. However, for characterization purpose, this kind of thermal sources are very useful. Like for infrared spectroscopy, optical spectroscopy, absorption spectroscopy. So we do not know beforehand what is the absorption profile of the material, so which wavelength we have to choose. So then you have to basically use large number of LEDs to excite and get the output, so which is not feasible over a large range. So therefore, there we have to use thermal sources. for spectroscopic purpose. The main uses of are in optical device characterization, in fact. This can also be used to detect radiations of very feeble, very low energy particles as well, which are may not be, whose characteristics may not be known. Like say, if you want to use the energy or want to count particles like neutrino, etc. So then you one has to go for such kind of detectors. So, however, for making such kind of sensitive detectors, a large number of thermocouples need to be put in series. So, like say, maybe thousands or even several hundreds of thousands thermocouples are put in series to get a detectable output from radiation of some unknown particles. Those are usually known as thermopiles when thermocouples are put in series. And for popular infrared detectors, thermistors are put in series. So those are known as bolometers. And typical IR camera, which are detecting thermal radiation, known as thermal camera, Fluke, given by Fluke, etc., commercially available at market, those are made of thermistors in series. So, however, we shall continue our discussion on optical sources. We shall discuss next is the semiconductor sources, but that's a different topic. So I shall discuss a little bit of semiconductor sources tomorrow. We will not go into detail of those properties. However, some characteristics and little bit of maybe kind of devices, construction, some fundamental I shall discuss.